Major funding for this program is made possible by grants from HSH Nordbank New York Branch and First American Title Insurance Company of New York, Perfect Building Maintenance, Greenberg Traurig LP, The Moynihan Group. Additional funding for this program is made possible by grants from Ann Terry's Real Estate, Arbor Realty Trust, C.B. Richard Ellis, Cushman & Wakefield, Fremont Investment and Loan, Massey Knackel Realty Services, Muss Development LLC, Rosenthal and Rosenthal Inc., Signature Bank, Stonehenge Partners, Swig Equities, the Engel Berman Group, the Wyckoff Group, Titan Capital, YL Real Estate Developers.
Welcome to Building New York. My name is Michael Stoller. Lots of people like to develop in the city of New York. Some people develop outside the city of New York. Today I have someone who's developed in the city of New York and outside of New York, but is opening up next month one of the most fantastic residential buildings, a mixed-use building right near Madison Square Garden. It's called The Epic. I'd like to welcome Hal Fettner of Sidney Fettner Associates today.
Thank you, Michael.
So, Hal, you know, when we met, we were talking about, it really goes back to your grandfather, Herman. Herman came over from Poland.
Yep.
And he was a feisty carpenter, right? You know, he was out there, a feisty carpenter. How did Herman get into the construction business or the carpentry business or even the development business?
Herman, all the people I've ever met that remember my grandpa told me he was a big guy. Big guy, big hands. He was a carpenter in Poland, came over on the boat, came to New York, went to the Bronx, and was a carpenter in the Bronx, and realized that he wasn't making a good enough living just being a carpenter, and so he started building his own buildings, just little projects at a time.
What kind of buildings did he build?
He ended up building a lot of the tenements that are today's tenements in the Bronx, but, you know, five-story buildings, plank jobs, what we call plank jobs today.
So that was Herman, and then in what, 1952, your dad joined him?
Well,
something like,
you know, my father was with my grandpa, you know.
Right.
As a young boy, always working. My grandpa had built a number of buildings in the Bronx and actually created a nice family income for himself and my dad and my uncle. But unfortunately lost it all during the Depression.
That's right, you had told me about that.
Yeah. So my father grew up, ultimately my father ended up growing up very poor. And it was that value system, that remembrance of the hard times, that he really imparted on my sisters and myself in terms of learning the value of the dollar.
So now your father created, he started Sidney Fettner, which was his name. When did he start that?
Around 1951, 1952.
And he was building, you told me when we met, gas stations originally?
When he went off on his own, he started building smaller projects. He built, I think it was either Mobil or Exxon, he was their exclusive construction manager in the Northeast. So he built a number of gas stations and a number of all over.
But as a builder, not as an owner?
As a builder.
As a builder.
Absolutely. But, he was also a contractor for the government. He built some buildings on Plum Island in Long Island Sound. And he just, whatever he could get his hands into, he was a builder.
And then he built something, he went to the west side, went to the Westerly, 54th Street and 8th Avenue?
55th and 8th was his first building in Manhattan. And that was actually after he built a complex in Larchmont, off of Washington Street in Larchmont. But then his first building that he built in Manhattan was in the West 50s on 8th Avenue called the Westerly, which was a building that was way beyond its time. Very, very early. You know, he had a hard time leasing it up, but it ultimately was a successful building.
Right, and you told me that this was a building, you know, it was near Broadway and all of this interesting thing. He had Liza Minnelli, he had Diana Ross,
I believe, lived in the building.
And he had a number of women who had their own solo businesses.
He was not aware of that business until, as a story I told you,
but that relates to the next one, because you said later on in life he went over to the east side and he built the other building.
He built another building on the east side. Loved his staff on the west side and said, all right, I'm going to move you guys. Come on. He wanted to take one or two of his favorite doormen to the east side. And they didn't want to go. And my father's like, but I'm going to pay you more money. And the doormen were basically, leave me where we are. Don't pay me any salary. And I'll stay in this building. And it was only then that he realized that they were being paid, you know, by...
They got gratuities.
From the women residents who had their solo business.
So we get you. You know, this guy, 46 years of age, grew up in Porchester?
Porchester, New York.
Porchester, New York.
Which became Rybrook, New York.
Became Rybrook. You know, the evolution of the neighborhood. So you go there, and what happens is... you're born, and you have two sisters, one of them who happens to be in business with you, Randy, I believe.
Randy.
And at 4 years of age, you go on the job sites? Sydney really wanted to get you into that business.
I was destined from the day I was born to be on the job sites. In fact, as you know, folklore has it, the man who drove me home from the hospital with my mom actually still works for us. Was one of my dad's construction workers. And so I was on the job sites from a very, very early age. And around the age of four, I would sit on the knee of one of the crane operators or the bulldozer operator. And, and I used to love to be on my job sites.
So you graduate high school and you decide to go to Syracuse.
Orangeman. Absolutely.
You want to be Orange. I'm a favorite. I'm Michigan, but the way they played in the Rose Bowl, it didn't matter. So you go over, you go to Syracuse, and he told me an interesting story. One summer, I think it was the first year maybe that you were in the semester, you got a job as a union carpenter. Tell my audience. Right. It's an interesting story.
Well, you know, I actually worked almost every summer, even in high school, on job sites. I actually worked in some of my dad's buildings as a porter. My father believed very strongly that for all his kids, you learn it from the ground up. So I cleaned toilets, I cleaned apartments. I had worked on the job sites as water boys and a gopher. But during college, my father had me work on a job site, but he wanted me to be a carpenter. He didn't realize that the union was going to take challenge to this, and they had to put me into the union. So all of a sudden, instead of making a few dollars, I was making a lot of money. And he got very nervous that I was going to make so much money that I'm going to say, I don't want to go back to school. Primarily because that's what he did as a young kid. He started to make a lot of money and then put off his college education because he started making a lot of money.
But you know, when you and I met, you said to me, you really wanted to prolong growing up, perhaps. You know, you spent 4 years at Syracuse, and, you know, you always worked. Even when you were a kid, you cut lawns, you did other things. But you really wanted to prolong it. And you said you graduate Syracuse, then you get a job with Dorman and Wilson.
I worked a year in Dorman and Wilson. Then I worked another, half a year with my father.
And then you decided to have the profession of a lawyer. Why do you want to become a lawyer?
I didn't want to be a lawyer.
Besides prolonging.
I didn't want to be a lawyer. When I was in college, I took a number of graduate courses at Syracuse. So had I gone for my MBA, I would have gotten it very quickly. So I did want to prolong going into the real world. But that two-year period after college, I had lost a deal that I had put together because of lawyers. And I finally decided, you know what, I want to understand what they're thinking. I don't want to be a lawyer, but I never want to lose a deal because of the lawyers. And so I really wanted to be able to negotiate my own deals. I wanted to be able to never have a lawyer tell me something that's not accurate. And I really wanted that discipline that you get in law school. And so I ultimately decided I wanted to go to law school to use in business.
So you go to New York Law.
Went to New York Law.
And you graduate in 1987.
Graduated in June of 87.
And then, because you were ready, you know, prolonged everything, but you were ready to join your dad. And then, unfortunately, your father gets ill.
Absolutely.
And you get married in November of that year.
Okay, November of 87.
Right, and then unfortunately your dad goes into the hospital in December and doesn't come out. And then, so you're 28 years of age, and you got a company called Sidney Fetner Associates. You also have a concrete company, because your dad had, during those days, had some situation, and when it also kept that development, XL Construction.
XLO.
XLO. And you told me you were a little nervous. This was a lot to bear.
Wouldn't you be?
I agree.
28 years old. My father had really done well for himself. Again, both my sisters and I grew up. He was a tough man, and he really believed in learning the value of the dollar. But we were all educated for this day, to be honest with you. We were trained for this day. But I mean, I did. I woke up one day, I didn't have my father, and I was now running the company. And it's a lot of responsibility, because it's a family business. And we have people at that time who had worked for us for 20 some odd years. So it wasn't that I was just taking care of my mom and my two sisters. I was taking care of my mom, my two sisters, and all of our employees, many of which who still work with me today.
Now, but what also happened, It was, you know, some people say it was the best of times, the worst of times. It was 1988, and it was a tough time. The real estate
bad
market
time.
Was going down in as the proverbial lower crapper. And you're here, green, naive a little bit. And fortunately, one of your dad's friends was Larry Silverstein, you said.
Right.
And Larry was your mentor and really gave you some good advice.
You know, Larry and my dad were good friends. Through the boating, we both had boats, but you know, never did I expect Larry to do what he did for us. I mean, he really, Larry was a fantastic guy after my father died, and really would say, "Come on, have breakfast, and what are you thinking about? What are you doing? Yeah, you know, I like that idea. You should pursue that." And so we would periodically have breakfast or lunch, and he would just basically give me advice and really reinforce, "You know what? You know what you're doing. You're doing the right thing," and sometimes doing the right thing was doing nothing. Because I got to tell you, from 1988 to 1991, 92, those were bad times here in New York.
Right. It was tough times. And then you got involved. I mean, some people who realized it was something called the RTC, you got involved with certain workouts of the RTC and so on. But I think you told me an interesting story which really took you to the next step, you know, after taking the business and taking care of the family. It's you're a runner. And
right.
you were living, you had bought your house, where was the house?
Somers, New York.
Somers, New York, and one day you're running and you see this field. And as you said to me, it was God's desire for you to run in the field. What happened?
You know, I've always been a runner. And I'd run through it was actually a woods, but, you know, miles. And you know, after about a year of running in these woods, I was like, you know, I don't even know whose property I'm running on. And that started the process of looking into who owned this property. And when all of a sudden one day I find out it's a piece of property that had been or is in a foreclosure proceeding, because the bank, which was at the time I believe Yorkville Federal Savings and Loan, had gone down, and it was being taken over by the RTC.
So how many acres were there?
This was 200 acres.
Okay. Now, I understand that your dad had built, but this was 200 acres, a little thing, and in the suburbs. I don't think you were going to be able to build a high-rise apartment house.
If you really want to know, everything about this deal was against what my father always believed in. He was not a big believer in land banking. And in fact, you know, I do need to go back to that 3-4 year period. In 88 to 90, 91, 92, it was for me a great period, because I was able to get my hands around the company, figure out what I wanted to do in life, but more importantly, I figured out what I know and what I don't know. And from there, I started surrounding myself with people who complemented my skills. That plus the fact that I started realizing that there was a lot of opportunities with the RTC, and I see this piece of property, I bought my own house in Somers, that there was a value play here. And it was really simply that, you know, the Fetner family, thank the dear Lord, had some cash sitting in the bank that we were doing nothing with for 3-4 years. You know, I said, you know, I'm going to pursue this. Even though my father hated land banking, we just felt that it was the right deal at the right time.
Right. And then in the RTC days, before you really, you started buying some properties in other states, even though we're tri-state, you know, we'll talk about that for short. Something in Highlands Park?
Well, Springfield, Virginia. Again, another, we bought the note on a failed property in Springfield, Virginia, which was about 100,000 square feet warehouse and office building that we repositioned and ultimately leased up 100%.
But I want to get to the New York, but I can't get to New York without talking about the Moraine, Ohio, because I think this is so interesting that my viewers would love it.
I always tell people that, you know, people that I love, you should only have a Moraine, Ohio in your life. And Moraine, Ohio is a 500,000 square foot complex that was built by the federal government in the 60s. Reagan gave 3 of the 4 buildings to the city of Moraine in 1980. The city of Moraine did nothing with these buildings from 1980 until about 95, did nothing with these buildings. I had been approached because someone knew I had bought the property in Springfield, Virginia, and said, oh, if you love warehouse, do I have a deal for you? And I actually didn't want to go out to Dayton, Ohio to look at property, but he was very persistent. I went out there, and I see 3 buildings, 1,000 feet long by 200 feet wide. Roofs had caved in, trees were growing out of the floor, and I'm saying to myself, why is it a New York developer, you know, is going to be able to figure this out and not someone local? And to this day, I still ask myself that question. But we looked at it, we decided to go and try to buy the property. I tried to buy it for what I felt was the value of the land, because at the time, there was about a 15% vacancy factor in that area for industrial property. You had a GM plant about 150 yards down the street from here. So I said, worst case scenario, I'll undercut the market, refurbish these buildings, undercut the market, and go to GM. 5 days after I bought the property, I was contacted by the federal government saying, we understand you're the new owner of this property. You know what? We might need some space. First request they needed was for about 25,000 square feet. Then they, maybe we need 50,000. And the next thing I know, they ended up taking 425,000 square feet of my 500,000 square foot facility. Then they realized that they can't afford to shelve it, because if the federal government bought the shelving, they had to buy it through the prison system, which was much more expensive than I could buy it from on a competitive bid basis. So we ended up shelving 425,000 square feet, entered into a long-term lease with the federal government, and we now store 1/2 of the entire country's tax returns in this facility.
Okay, now let's get back to New York. We got 10 minutes left to the show, and now it's 1994, and you assemble a site called, where you subsequently later called the Chesapeake.
Right.
Tell me about the Chesapeake.
You know, every night I drive home, I go up First Avenue, and it was this empty lot on the corner of 94th and First Avenue. And so we, one day I approached the owner, who did not know who the owner was when I went to the land book to find him, and ultimately was someone who knew my dad. So he ended up needing to have to sell that property. So we bought the land. Again, when I bought it in that piece I bought 93, it was a land bank deal.
And then subsequently, you built the Chesapeake, which is on 94th and
345 East 94th Street.
And that's an 80-20 apartment house, 20% affordable, which everybody who watches my show knows I love affordability, and that's what you've done on all of it. And that was the first building that you really built under the Sidney Fetner, under Hal Fetner, let's say.
That was my first building that I built without my dad.
The next one is a very interesting story, because you go to East End Avenue, and you're dealing with a man who I remember, Ziggy Wallach. And tell my audience, it's a great story. They say sometimes things are bichette or meant to be. Ziggy was a survivor.
Ziggy was a survivor. And Siegfried Wallach apparently escaped from the Nazis on December 31st, 1939, through a small town in Poland. And when I first was introduced to Siegfried Wallach, he would talk to me for 5 minutes about the property and then want to know what charities I was involved in. And you know, we would talk about UGA, we would talk about Israel Bonds, we'd talk about Einstein for 25, 30 minutes. And he said, you know what, I got to leave. You know, come back next week. My broker was getting very frustrated. It was only around the third or the fourth time that I was meeting with Siegfried Wallach that he mentioned to me that he came to the States through Poland. I happened to mention my dad's family was from Poland. He said, where? I said, from a little town called Horodanka. At which point, Siegfried got up from his desk, came over to me and said, stand up. And I stood up and he gave me a big hug. And it was from Horodanka that he escaped the Nazis.
And subsequently, he sold you the land.
Well, at that moment, my broker, as I left that meeting, my broker looked at me and says, either you are the most lucky person I've ever in my life met, or you have the uncanny ability to do great research. And at that point, I knew that I was going to make this deal with Siegfried.
And there, subsequently, you built 55 condominiums on East End Avenue. 90 East End?
90 East End Avenue. And it was a luxury condominium building that we were.
And so now you have these places, East End Avenue, the Chesapeake. Then you go to Times Square on a place that 25 years everybody hates it, the Victory. Tell me a little bit about the Victory.
Yeah, the Victory, interesting site. The Victory, many developers before me tried to calm the storm on this particular site. There were some very bad people that owned this property in the late 60s.
This is on 42nd Street?
This is on 42nd to 41st and 10th Avenue. And you know, we had heard stories of just bad things that took place in the basement, clogging up the drains so that sewage would come into the basement and the smell, the foul smell, would permeate throughout the building so that residents would move out. I mean, they were doing all these bad things to get people to move out of the buildings. That ultimately, the first harassment charge on a piece of property was placed on this property in the mid to late 70s, early 80s. And ultimately, the property was taken over by the FDIC. It was purchased by Bruce, the whole property was bought by Bruce Brickman and Associates. They were having a hard time cleaning up the problems. Excuse me. And then they approached me. And we ultimately...
And what'd you build over there?
Well, we ended up building a 49-story building. But that's not the story here.
I know.
That's not the story. The story was that we owned three tenements on 42nd Street, 500, 502, 506. We ended up partnering up with a local not-for-profit called Clinton Housing Development Group, a guy named Joe Restuccio, great guy, and ultimately worked with him to what's called satisfy the cure.
Right, and you basically built apartments with him, and you gave those apartments to Clinton Housing.
Right, on the corner of 42nd and 10th, which is you talk about what you're proud of. I'm very proud of that restoration because the building turned out beautiful and we really wanted to stay true to the original intent of that building. It was designed by Ernest Flagg, great architect of the late
1800s. You know, if you want to be proud, I think what you and Douglas Durst and the Franciscan Friars are doing today...
So you want to talk about the epic.
...is the epic. The epic, which is on 31st to 32nd Street between 6th Avenue and 7th Avenue, right near the Garden. That's a story.
That's a great story. Well, you know what? That is the culmination of many, many years. When I lived in Somers, I used to take the train in periodically into the city. And it took my wife to really introduce me to the Durst. My father knew...
Seymour?
My father knew Seymour and David. And it was really my wife, Nina, who became friendly with Jody Durst and introduced me to him. On the train, they were just getting ready to start building 4 Times Square. And we would talk a lot about the green technology that they were putting into that building. And I said, you know what, how do I use this in one of my buildings? I would love to take that technology and bring it into a residential building. There's a social responsibility that I would love to basically impart on my residents. And so we got excited about that. And in fact, Battery Park now started to turn green and we were one of the bidders to bid on the very first Site 18A that ultimately the Albanese family built. And we were excited to try to do that as a joint venture with the Durst. We ultimately lost. And then there was this RFP by the Franciscan Friars to build this site on 31st and...
So tell me, because we got 3 minutes left, okay. What is the epic? I mean, it has a great name, but what is it? Because it's five condominiums. It's really...
The epic
It's really a culmination.
The epic is a joint venture between the Durst family, the Fetner family, and the Franciscan Friars. They decided to stay in as our partners. And it is a building that basically has three different users. I have 438 apartments in there.
20% affordable, once
20%
again.
20% affordable. I built a 35,000 square foot rectory for the Franciscan Friars, so they will live in there with their own entrance, their own elevator base. And then there is a 77,000 square foot American Cancer Facility, which is going to be their Eastern Seaboard headquarters, as well as 72 hotel-type suites.
The Hope Lodge, the first Hope Lodge
First vertical Hope Lodge.
Especially in New York City. It's the first Hope Lodge. Right. Now, so that's not enough for Hal Fetner. So now, in a couple months, you're going to break ground. You're going up to, going north of 96th Street. You're going to 110th?
110th and 5th.
And what are you building there?
We're going to be building about 112 condominium units that is going to be above the African Art Museum. And a great, great project. We're working as a joint venture with the African Art Museum. And this is a joint venture with Bruce Brickman and Associates, who we bought 41st Street from and ultimately did three or four more deals. Bought a number of properties with Bruce Brickman and Associates.
But this is interesting because, you know, you have the museum in the base, and you have the park over there, and you have Fifth Avenue. And I remember you and I sat, because you've been on the other show, when you bought this, New York City is a great place. This wasn't really ready at that time.
Which, 110th and 5th?
Yeah, at that...
You know what, we started on this deal about 4 years ago. You know what? There's not a lot of property to be purchased in Fifth Avenue across from Central Park.
I agree.
So, I mean, I don't know how wrong you can go.
You know, you said to me that what you pride yourself is you're a larger company today, but you're a family company. And you pride yourself on your people, yeah. Your colleague, your partners. Your sister's one of your partners. You have another partner, Damon, who's been with you. And I think the idea of you could still be a family business and, you know.
You know, I go back to what I said earlier, which is the best period was the worst period of my life, right after my father passed away, because it was really a great time for me to just take stock, figure out what I know, figure out what I don't know, figure out what I wanted to do in life when I grew up. And, you know, it was then that I realized that I need help in certain areas. And the greatest investment I ever made was with Damon Pasolini, who was my banker at KeyBank.
Okay. You know something? Herman, Sidney, today Hal, with Damon, with the Dursts, with the Brickmans, you've done a lot. You've built New York, and I'm happy you've been my guest today, and I'll see you soon.
Thank you, Michael.
Okay.
Major funding for this program is made possible by grants from HSH Nordbank New York Branch and First American Title Insurance Company of New York, Perfect Building Maintenance, Greenberg Traurig LP, The Moynihan Group. Additional funding for this program is made possible by grants from Ann Terry's Real Estate, Arbor Realty Trust, C.B. Richard Ellis, Cushman and Wakefield, Fremont Investment and Loan, Massey Nackel Realty Services, Muss Development LLC, Rosenthal and Rosenthal Inc., Signature Bank, Stonehenge Partners, Swig Equities, The Engel Berman Group, The Wyckoff Group, Titan Capital, YL Real Estate Developers.